station. Leroy played for West Ham, he played for Fulham, and he managed several teams, including the Sierra Leone national team. Leroy Rossignol.
Evening. On a serious note, and this is only going to be the only serious note of the night, we're here to combat the BNP. So I just want to remind you where we've come from, because people seem to forget. You know, when I started playing, you know, on a day-to-day basis, people would call me names, people would throw bananas at me. At least 10,000 people would do the Nazi salute, and a little boy of 10 years old spat on me as I came off the pitch. And that wasn't so long ago. So I'm here today to make sure that doesn't happen to my children and your children. And that's why I'm very proud of the work that we do, because it is really, really important. And I'll tell you a story, not to do with football, but to do with my sisters. I'm the only boy, and I've got four sisters, Lauren, Linda, Lorna, Lena, and I'm Leroy. Yeah, my dad was a little bit eccentric, to say so. He was. You knew him well. But when I was growing up in school, I never knew anything about racism. I went to school, and if anything happens, my sisters would sort it out. It wouldn't be a problem. The only time it touched me is when there were poems like Love Thy Neighbour, Until Death Us Do Part, and people would want to reenact their jokes out on me. And so it never touched me. But when I grew up in South London, and I can see Brixton Prison where I grew up, everybody who lived around us were Polish, Jamaican, Irish, Scottish, of all different denominations. They all used to come to our house and have a party, because ours was a party house. And for those of you, some of you, I'm looking around you, some of you look a little bit young, but does anybody remember the car wash dance? Well, if you come to my house, you had to try and do the car wash. It was like kick, kick, jump, jump, kick, kick. And our neighbours used to come round for about 15 years, and after 15 years, they were really, really crap at it. So I had a really good time. I wasn't touched by racism at all until I started playing football, and all those things started to happen to me. But one of the things that happened to my sisters, who used to look after me when I was a kid, was when they first came to watch me play at Queen's Park Rangers, I went up after the game. I scored the winning goal. It was 1-0. I scored the winner after 90 minutes. You know, I was a striker. I played rubbish, but it didn't matter because I scored the goal. I should get all the back pages. But anyway, I walked in and this young man came up to me and said, "Can I have your autograph?" And I said, "Of course you can. Yeah, you can have my autograph. I'd practice it for 20 years. This was the time it's going to..." Yeah. And as I walked up to my sister Linda, she said, "Look, can we go?" And I said, "Why? What's the matter?" She said, "Look, we just need to get out of it." So we went home, and I said, "Oh, what was up with you there? You know, I scored the goal. You know, I thought you want to stay and have a drink." She said, "Well, that man who asked you for your autograph was sat behind you for 90 minutes, calling you names. You black this, you black that." And my four sisters were the only four black people in that ground, 20,000 people. And that was the only time they never went back to watch me play. So the only time I could have looked after my sister, I failed to do that. And I vowed that would never happen again. So the work we do now when we go into schools is to make sure that people don't have to go through that anymore. And our kids aren't stupid. They ask questions like, why is there racism? Why do people do it? And they want to know the answers. And it's sometimes really difficult to give them those answers. But what we can do is make sure that they don't grow up being racist. And that they recognise it first and foremost, because that's the first thing. Some people don't even recognise that they're being racist. And when they recognise it, that they stop doing it. And that's really important. So that's the work we do. And the resources we have, you can find out for yourself. They're everywhere. And you can use them not just for teaching, but in everyday life. And people say to me, "Do you think there's never going to be racism again?" A lot of people say, "Oh no, I think there's always going to be racism." Well, I think that's a load of rubbish. I think one day racism will be confined to history. And we've all got to play a part in making sure that that is the case. I'll tell you a story about a guy called Justin Fashanu. Does anybody remember Justin Fashanu? I tell this story to everybody because it is very, very important. When I was at West Ham, Justin came on loan for 3 months, and Justin was gay, though all those years ago, openly gay, and obviously was black. So that was a double whammy in those days, believe me. That was really tough.
West Ham as well.
He was West Ham as well. Exactly. 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 You black... Oh, you play for West Ham. No, sorry, it's all right. So it was tough. But he came in, and in those days, we had big baths, girls. You wouldn't see it now because of health and safety. Big baths. We all sat in the bath. And I sat with two white guys who played for West Ham. I won't mention their names. And Justin walked in. He was 6'4". magnificent looking guy. He walked in and these two guys got up and walked out. I'd like to think it's because of that. You know what people say about black guys? That stereotypical thing that they say. I'd like to think that, but I don't think it was. Okay? But they got out. They walked out straight out of the bath. It was obvious why they walked out. And I sat and I spoke to Justin and got to know him. And although he was only there for 3 months, I got to know him. He's a nice guy. Didn't know him really, really well. The next thing I heard about Justin had hung himself 15 years later in a garage. And I thought about that time in the bath where those two guys got up and walked out. And I thought about what could I have done? Could I have done something? Of course I could. I could have challenged those two guys. And when I think about those two guys, if I had challenged them at the time and spoken to them about it, I'm sure they might have just changed their way of thinking, just a little bit. And so my message to you is don't let any opportunity you ever have to make a difference pass you by. They've all got times, and I'm sure we can all remember when we could have and maybe should have done something, and that opportunity went. So that's the other reason why I'm here, because I will never let that happen again in my lifetime. I hope you don't too. So tonight is a fantastic opportunity, not only for us to get together and have a good time, but after tonight, remember, when you wake up in the morning with that hangover, I'm going to be all right because I'm driving home, but when you wake up in the morning with that thick head, to tell your friends about it, make sure they get on YouTube and that we get the message out there. And we make sure that we don't go back to those days where people used to spit on me, where 20,000 people used to do the Nazi salute, where a little boy of 10 who would now be 38 spat on me. And he's most probably a member of that BNP now. Let's make sure those days don't come back, okay? Thank you.